season. I'm pretty excited to separate the beginners from everybody else. We can do a little bit more music, add a few solos. You guys don't need to feel like you're coming to a very brief, tentative concert and then just, you know, sit there for all the rest of the time. I know that some of you guys probably do enjoy hearing the older groups, but hey, look, everybody's busy and everybody has life that goes on. My wife right now is at the vet with our 18-year-old cat, who's been alive with us since we got married when we were at USC in 1999. So life happens, and it happens at you fast, and you just got to deal with stuff. So I understand you guys taking your precious time away from your families to come here to this concert. My prayer is that the Lord would give that back, that time back to you supernaturally, and you guys will also just really enjoy our show. And so thank you for coming. We got a lot of music packed in, and I'm just excited. This is a great group of beginners. There's a group of, you'll see in the program, there's a group of beginner seventh graders. And sometimes people think that if they missed an opportunity in the sixth grade, that they can't take again. So we have the opportunity to provide a beginner seventh grade class. And some of the guys that took it, was just the relationship going down the halls last year. You know, hey, you guys want to take strings, you guys want to take strings. And they didn't know whether they wanted to or not, because it wasn't something initially thought they would sign up for. And they've done great. It's actually, I'm going to be honest with you, the beginner seventh grade class really has been my most fun class, because I didn't know what to expect out of them, and they've just flown. So I'm proud of them. The beginner sixth grade class, a lot of them are coming to me right after gym, at the end of the day, after they've taken everything, in a small classroom, there's like 30 kids. So you can imagine it's pretty hectic and wild at the very end of the day. But we've had a great time, they've done a good job, and so you as parents ought to be proud. Also, because it's a beginner concert, and I feel like I don't really have the opportunity, I'm going to take the time to kind of educate you guys and teach you some of the things that the kids are learning, so that when we're playing a particular piece, you're not just hearing one tune to the next tune. There's skills involved in what they've learned. They can't play this particular tune because they haven't learned these particular skills. So I want you guys to just kind of be aware. When I started explaining that when my wife was coming to the shows and my kids were little, she really got a lot out of that. But you know, we get kind of nervous as directors, so we just kind of like rush through everything. And as parents, we enjoy learning about what our kids are learning in school. So I'm going to try to take the chance to kind of, you know, allow you to be more informed, as well as maybe talk a few things about rehearsal etiquette. Please have everybody, there's enough seats, everybody can sit the whole time. One of the reasons why I didn't have you guys on the Tuesday concert, because at Christmas, there was no seats left. And there were people standing and people running around everywhere. I try to have a short show so that, because people are bringing children, everybody's running around. You know, these kids have worked hard, so we try to have a quiet environment while they're playing. So I would appreciate that, and that you guys can appreciate that too, to try to create a distraction-free environment. I know I don't like a lot of noise going on when I pay some money to go see a movie. And so I know you didn't pay to come to the concert, but it's that same kind of atmosphere. You know, they have the commercials in front of the movie that say, please shut off your cell phone, and you don't be the annoying guy in the movie. And I'm generally that annoying guy that laughs really loudly. My son Noah had to tell me to be quiet. When I took him when he was two or three to come from Canada, I was the loudest person in the auditorium. And he was like, man, you have got to be quiet. So those kind of things that we kind of take for granted. But at the very beginning, we're going to do a warm-up, just kind of get everybody's nerves kind of settled, and we're going to do three scales. And then the three scales that we're going to, there are three different finger patterns that the kids kind of learn. If you've got four fingers, think about this with your left hand. So we're talking about a left-hand technique thing, okay? They finger all the notes with their left hand like this, or like this if you play cello or bass. And if you got four fingers, if I go like this, there's space between every single finger. Every tune that we play is not with this same shape. Sometimes we play a tune with this shape. Sometimes we play a tune with this shape. Sometimes we play a tune with this shape. Sometimes we have the Star Trek shape. Okay, that happens too. And it's really difficult, especially when you have four strings and you're crossing strings. One string will be like this, and the next string will be like this. And sometimes you're going backwards. between the strings really fast. And so that is a skill that the kids learn. It takes a while to kind of do that. That's why beginning strings kind of sounds in tune, kind of doesn't sound in tune. And so then you have to develop their ear and they'll be able to do that. So we're going to warm up with three different scales, and then we're going to go right into Candyman and Surprise Symphony. So we'll do all of that, and then you'll see the program. We'll have a couple of solos at that point. Okay, so thank you. Enjoy the beginning of our concert.
Thank you.
take just a second. You know, if I were to try to speak in a different accent, you know, normally I'm from South Carolina, so I talk something like this. And I've noticed when I moved here from Anderson that this is how I talk when I go home and talk to my parents and my wife's parents. You know, and I try to talk like that, talk a little more, you know, formal when I'm in front of a crowd. But you know, when I'm informally cornbread at dinner table, we revert to this kind of talk like this. Ainer has another whole different accent. It's not my Andersonian accent, you know, but it's okay. And if I were to want to change the way that I talk, if I wanted to sound like I'm Scottish, or I want to eat something, whatever, I would have to change the way I articulated my words. Does it make sense? I'm just changing. That's the reason why somebody that's from South Carolina can be an opera singer and you have no idea where they're from. When people go with a skill set, the way that you speak, the way that you become an orator, you have training in the way that you communicate. So if somebody gets a job and they're on television, you know, that's one of those skills that they have learned how to do. So they kind of appeal to everybody, you know. One of the ways that we make music sound different is articulating differently with the bow. So, so I want you to play just on the D string, just the D string. And I want you to play four notes in. Right. And I just want you to play four D's, and I want you to connect those D's while you play. Ready? And you see how all those notes were connected? That's just the normal bow stroke where we just go down, up, down, up. That's called a detaché bow stroke. Just some fancy name. I think it's German. Right? So it's called detaché. Even though it's spelled detached, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. You know, the thing that wouldn't happen, there'll be little spaces. When we do a long stroke really fast with a little bit of disconnect, so you can do a long bow, you can go over four over D, 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 D. Do just a little bit of disconnect that way, the frog and tip. One, two, ready. Stop. Okay. And so that bow stroke right there is called a martelet bow stroke. So it's a long stroke and a little bit of detachment. I mean, if we shorten the bow down and do the same thing, the same tempo, you're going to go the same tempo. You're not going to be faster. But you're going to use the timing on those. You go. Stop. That's a staccato bow. So when we were playing this surprise symphony, you probably recognize how short they were using their bows. So one of the things they've learned is how to articulate different sounds on their instrument. And that's hard to do. That's hard to get kids to really understand that because their brains are doing so many things all at different times. I can't do one thing at once. I'm surprised I can play the violin this night. But because there's so many things, you got left hand, you got right hand, reading the notes proficiently is really difficult. So if you're teachers and you know anything about high Lexile scores and fluency and reading, all of that holds true when we're teaching kids music. So just be aware as parents, when you feel like you haven't heard all that progress and they're practicing all the time, there's a lot that goes into it. And so be patient as it practice occurs, then do a little bit more practice. And then maybe you ask kids, you are awesome. You have to take this. Maybe ask your kids to play the same song but articulate it differently. And that way you're reinforcing what I'm doing in the classroom. Okay? So thank you. That's what I want to make sure that you guys do this, what we're doing right here.
How many years does it take?
Now we're going to hear a song. How much is it? This is Zong Zhao, and he's going to play Astro for us. This is actually at the back of the second book. Most of us have only gotten to do the first book, but this is at the back of the second book. So I asked him to play it. I didn't tell him this book was from. I just said, hey, I want you to play some concert. And he just took off.
he said, no. He said, no, not really.
I'll be speaking.
Six.
types of string instruments in orchestra. We have the violin and the viola, and the difference between the violin and the viola, the violin is one everybody kind of knows, it's kind of high and trebly type sound. Play your lower string and listen. Kathy, you want to stand up? Alright, so play your lower string. Now play your higher string. Alright, Kathy, play your lower string. Play your instrument. Alright, now if you heard both those instruments kind of perform and both of them play the same thing, the violin has more of a bright, trebly sound, the viola has more of a dark sound. And I kind of liken the viola to kind of like Batman, because it's always dark and Batman stuff. And the Superman always is nice, bright, vivid color. You know what I mean? So I kind of think of it kind of like that. So Gavin's going to play a song from a piece for us called Long, Long Ago on the viola. Kids, you know, we're like contemporaries for the most, you know what I mean, like some of us became moms and dads at the same time, you know? And we have kids the same age. And my oldest son is right there doing video, which I greatly appreciate. And I have been blessed and honored to be able to be his teacher for 3 years. That's rare. But sometimes the kids, you don't know what they're doing. And you're like, all right, do you have the light? Do you have it on? Is your own switch on right here? You know what I mean? As parents, especially when they're just kind of like on their device all the time. When they get that instrument up and they're playing, they're changing their finger patterns on different strings and they're thinking and they're reading music. Yeah, that is an awesome thing. And every one of these kids are doing that. But one of those things when you see these kids doing solos, they're getting having to do all the string crossings, reading music, they're getting all these things really quickly and they become really fluent while they're playing. That is, as parents, what you need to be kind of looking for as you see them practice at home. Okay. So you can help. Y'all can help. The next piece that we're going to perform with you is called Shouting. Yes. Kids will have an opportunity to do next year. That's kind of like competing on the tennis team. It's more of an individual-based thing. And the better individual kids that we have, the better the group's going to sound collectively, because everybody can play individually from the front to the back. You know, it's just depth on the team. And if you, I mean, I was a football person, and I went to South Carolina when we were 0-21. We had a pretty good first string and a horrible everything else. So one guy person got hurt, what happened? The whole team was just, you know, defeated the rest of the year because that one person couldn't play anymore. You know, we can't have orchestra, we can't have band, we can't have chorus like that. Everybody from the front to the back's important. Okay? So I just want to just throw out there, the more you can get your kids playing, and I know it's kind of difficult, like kids busy, right? But we're, I'm not talking about hours and hours, maybe just a consistent discipline of 10 minutes a day. I think everybody can try to do that. You know, I've tried to challenge my students to do the same kind of thing. So, I want you to enjoy these two ladies' performance. Abigail's going to play the Concerto number 2 she's been working on, and Nicole's going to play a sonata in C. All right, so.
Thank you.
guys, I hope you guys enjoyed your evening, and we'll see you next time.
Yeah.